I want you to hit me as hard as you can.
It seems hard to believe that Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory has already celebrated its 50th anniversary. Although it's now widely hailed as a timeless classic, the independently made big screen adaptation of Roald Dahl's beloved children's story actually did not perform well at the box office during its initial run, only slowly becoming a cult classic over time. Of course, just making this live-action story of a confection factory and its whimsical owner presented a series of challenges that were definitely not sweet, and the end product infuriated the author himself. Warn your dentist and sink your teeth into what the fuck happened to this movie. After a decade making documentary films, director Mel Stewart got the idea to adapt Charlie and the Chocolate Factory after his 10-year-old daughter read the book and asked him to turn it into a movie along with her Uncle Dave. Not actually related to the Stewarts, this Uncle Dave happened to be David L. Walper, a producer who took interest in the project almost immediately. Coincidentally, Walper was already working with Quaker Oats to introduce a new candy bar, and he convinced the company to purchase the book rights for $500,000 and also finance the film, with the understanding they would cross-promote their new candy bar and increase the company profile. In other words, the movie was essentially made to sell candy. One reason it was renamed from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory was to promote Quaker's Wonka brand. And while the company names have changed over the years, the candy line was so successful that even today, you can still buy various Wonka treats, including, appropriately, Everlasting Gobstoppers. Thanks for watching JoBlo videos. If you enjoy our shows, please like and subscribe, and click the bell to be notified when new videos go live. Now, back to the show! After funding for the movie was secured, Stewart agreed to hire Roald Dahl to adapt the screenplay from his own children's story. This decision presented one of the first major problems of the production, as Dahl failed to meet deadlines and turned in an outline devoid of crucial dramatic story beats, instead often just referencing sections of his own book. Walper then brought in documentary writer David Seltzer to do an uncredited rewrite in exchange for producing his next film. Dahl was extremely upset over the direction the revamped story took. His biggest complaint was that too much emphasis was placed on Wonka rather than Charlie Bucket, the impoverished young hero of the tale. Although Wonka does not even appear on screen until 44 minutes into the movie. Dahl also detested the subplot twist that turned Slugworth into a faux villainous spy. And he took issue with how the fizzy lifting drink sequence was expanded from his book. But Walper and Stewart felt these story changes would help radically increase the dramatic stakes. They also decided to make the movie a musical to add to the fantasy element, which was another aspect that Dahl disliked, calling the songs sappy and sentimental. For the role of the eccentric candy maker, all six members of Monty Python reportedly expressed interest. Peter Sellers lobbied hard for the role, but was turned down as Stewart wanted to avoid having such a prominent name in the lead. Fred Astaire famously wanted to play the enchanting chocolatier, but he was never seriously considered as he was 72 years old at the time. Joel Grey was the first choice to play Wonka, but Ron Moody, Frankie Howard, and John Pertwee were each offered the part and declined due to scheduling conflicts. Others considered included Dudley Moore, Peter Cook, and Michael Crawford. Roald Dahl was incensed when his first choice, Spike Milligan, was summarily dismissed by the filmmakers. But as the story goes, Mel Stewart knew he found his Wonka as soon as Gene Wilder entered the audition room. Wilder's actual audition sealed the deal, and Stewart said he chased the actor down the hall, grabbed his arm before he could reach the elevator, and insisted, "You're doing this picture, you are Willy Wonka." However, Wilder had very strong opinions about the character, and only agreed to play the part with a certain condition, that on his first entrance, he would have a cane and appear to be a cripple, only to reveal it as a trick. Wilder reasoned that this would ensure, from that point on, no one, in the movie or the audience, would know if he was lying or telling the truth. Once given the role, Wilder was allowed authorship of the character, making his own wardrobe choices that included the specifics of his iconic top hat. As Charlie Bucket, the poor but lucky lad who finds the golden ticket, Peter Ostrom was hastily cast just days before production officially commenced, beating out hundreds of other child actors. Character actor Jack Albertson would play Charlie's bedridden Grandpa Joe, whose selfishness seems to draw more internet disapproval with each passing year.
"'Cause I've got a golden ticket.'"
Meanwhile, famous Rat Packer Sammy Davis Jr. wanted the role of the kind candy shop owner, but the filmmakers thought having such a recognizable face in a minor role would be distracting. Ironically, Davis's subsequent rendition of The Candyman became one of his biggest songs and remains one of the film's most lasting legacies. With a budget of $3 million, principal photography on Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory started in August 1970 without a finished script. Seltzer continued to work on the script as cameras rolled, sending pages to the set as he finished them. Much of the film was shot in Munich, Germany, both for cost efficiency and the storybook quality of the area. Although Germany is known for its gourmet candy, the edible confections used in the film were shipped in from the US, prompting the young cast to lament how stale the treats often were by the time they reached the set. Most of the movie's chocolate bars were actually just wood props covered with Wonka wrappers. Unfortunately, not many of the mass-produced props were saved, something Mel Stewart deeply regretted after the film became a big success on home video, as they would surely be valuable collector's items. We all know the centerpiece of Wonka's factory involves a giant chocolate room. Conceived by production designer Harper Goff, the chocolate river was created by mixing 150,000 gallons of water with cocoa powder and cream, which at first resulted in a frightening blood-red color before the recipe was altered. According to actor Michael Bolner, who plays the gluttonous Augustus Gloop, the river was dirty, stinking water. A full-sized dummy was used for his dangerous tube traveling.
The suspense is terrible.
He's gonna go this time.
I hope it'll last.
The chocolate room's introduction in the movie was also the first time the children had seen the set, so their initial wonderment at the enormous goodie-filled room was very real. And many of the props were indeed edible, although Wonka's flower cup was not one of them. These props were formed out of wax, which Wilder had to spit out between each take. Wilder was intent on deliberately eliciting genuinely shocking reactions from his castmates during filming, and much like the movie itself, his performance alternates between tender and terrifying. For the psychedelic nightmare boat ride that's part of Wonka's wacky tour, the child actors were convinced that Wilder was suffering a meltdown caused by the trippy tunnel, and their authentic reactions were caught on camera. Even director Mel Stewart admitted he had no idea how the actor was going to perform the sequence and was as surprised as anyone. Another spontaneous instance was the climactic scene in Wonka's office, where he suddenly reprimands Charlie and Grandpa Joe for stealing fizzy lifting drink. During rehearsals, Wilder played the scene subdued and simply acted disappointed. When the cameras rolled, Wilder exploded into his histrionic speech and completely stunned Peter Ostrom and Jack Albertson in the process. One large blue challenge was the freaky transformation of Violet Beauregard. The scene had been scheduled around lunch break, requiring actress Denise Nickerson to stay in her cumbersome costume for much of the day, even needing to be regularly rotated to ensure she had proper blood circulation. And the Oompa Loompas struggled to accurately steer the inflated Violet, often sending her crashing into walls and necessitating numerous takes. Speaking of the Oompa Loompas, many were played by German locals who did not speak fluent English, which is why the unsettling Oompa Loompa song segments could require up to 50 takes to get right. Their fanciful coloring and design was a wise change from the problematic African pygmy slaves of Dahl's original book, but the makeup application and removal process was also quite burdensome for the actors. Filming could get so hot that their makeup would melt off between shots, causing constant touch-ups and making it extremely difficult to remove at the end of the day. The Oompa Loompa actors also became notorious for their hard partying after each day's filming, often hitting pubs and nightclubs together in a limousine, which kinda sounds like a spin-off movie we'd like to see.
Doo-ba-dee-doo.
Mike TV presented his own challenges. His miniaturized fate in the invention room, done before advanced special effects, required various complicated visual gimmicks and trickery, like an oversized TV set platform. But young actor Paris Themon himself was, allegedly, the real pain in the ass. He would tend to ignore instructions and goof around, and at one point deliberately released the bees in the Great Gum Machine, causing chaos on the set. The famously gracious Gene Wilder later described Themon as a little brat and a troublemaker. Actress Julie Dawn Cole initially was very withdrawn, unlike Veruca Salt, the spoiled little monster she plays on screen. Accompanied only by a chaperone she didn't know, Cole was incredibly homesick and has since said that Wilder went out of his way to comfort her. Cole and Denise Nickerson quickly both developed a crush on Peter Ostrom, leading to a rivalry on the set that sometimes even affected their ability to perform. Nickerson also later claimed that she got 13 cavities in her teeth from all the gum chewing and candy consumption on set. That dental damage wasn't the only set mishap. Wilder accidentally whacked some of the children several times with his cane while animatedly pointing to various marvels in the factory. Cole smashed her knee open on a rock she thought was a prop. There's even a glimpse of her blood-soaked stocking in the final film. the soda-powered Wonka-mobile reportedly belched a chemical foam that caused skin irritation requiring medical treatment. And the fizzy lifting drink wasn't exactly magical for Ostrom and Albertson, who were suspended at a disconcerting height with just piano wires and crotch-punishing harnesses. Filming also ran over schedule, causing production delays for the Liza Minnelli musical Cabaret, which required the same studio space in Munich. According to one actor, Cabaret director Bob Fosse would storm onto the Wonka set every day, shouting, "When is this goddamn movie ending?" Speaking of the ending, even that was done at the last minute. David Seltzer thought his job was done and had returned to the States, but Mel Stewart tracked him down on vacation in Maine and called him, desperate for new dialogue to end the picture. Off the top of his head, Seltzer came up with Wonka's final line, and everyone loved it.
"Don't forget what happened to the man who suddenly got everything he always wanted."
"What happened?"
"He lived happily ever after."
Paramount Pictures released Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory theatrically on June 30th, 1971. At the time, more adult-skewing movies like Airport, Carnal Knowledge, and Billy Jack were dominating the box office, and lighter family fare was often ignored. Willy Wonka ultimately grossed only $4 million in worldwide ticket sales on its $3 million production budget. Ironically, the Wonka candy bar that the film was made to promote actually had to be recalled when the movie was in theaters. There was an issue with the formula, and the chocolate was melting in the stores. Quaker Oats had spent millions of dollars on a feature-length advertisement for a product they couldn't even sell. But the film earned mostly favorable reviews, including a glowing 4-star review by Roger Ebert, who called it the best family movie of its kind since The Wizard of Oz. It wasn't until the mid-1970s, when the movie began airing on television during the holiday season, that it started gaining traction among viewers. Its television debut was on Thanksgiving night in 1974, and the results were so successful that the film aired again the following Thanksgiving, heading on its way to becoming an annual favorite. A decade later, in 1984, the film made its debut on home video, where it really began to find its audience and eventually became an all-time classic family film. Interestingly enough, after the Paramount deal lapsed in 1976, Walper had managed to sell the film rights to Warner Brothers. As a result, Warner's ended up profiting far more through home video and countless commemorative reissues over the years than Paramount ever did by distributing the film theatrically. This video success has led many to believe Willy Wonka is a Warner Brothers picture, when it was actually made independently, distributed by Paramount, and bought out by Warner's at an opportune time. Most of the movie's young actors quickly left show business behind after the production finished. One person who remained salty to the bitter end was Roald Dahl, who all but disowned the final version of the film, calling it crummy and describing Wilder's performance as pretentious. Even when it became a success and producers wanted to adapt his follow-up book, Charlie and the Great Glass Elevator, he vehemently declined. Gene Wilder earned a Golden Globe nomination for his unforgettable performance as Willy Wonka, and the film earned an Academy Award nomination for Best Music. The movie inspired a 2005 Tim Burton Johnny Depp remake, which Wilder publicly rebuked, and a prequel is on the way with Timothée Chalamet as the peculiar entrepreneur. In 2014, the movie was added to the U.S. National Film Registry for preservation. Gene Wilder, who will forever be associated with the capricious candy maker, even earning meme status, sadly passed away in 2016 at the age of 83. After more than half a century, Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory continues to endure like the movie's fictional candy.
"You can suck them and suck them and suck them, and they'll never get any smaller. Never."
Aside from Wilder's wonderfully weird title character, the movie will always be known for boasting elaborate set decorations, inventive production design, and the fantastically festooned confection factory that remains a huge part of the nostalgia and childhood appeal.
"The snozzberries taste like snozzberries."
Let us know your thoughts. Leave a comment in the comments. And thanks for watching.